following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, and it's a Monday. Welcome to a brand new week. To show you just how off kilter I am, earlier today when I did my What's News segment, I tweeted it out by saying, hey, it's Friday, August 10th. Wishful thinking or brain fart. Either way, it's not Friday, it's Monday. Ugh. But here it is, the beginning of a new week. And who knows what could transpire by the end of this week. Let's see. By this time Friday, we will likely know who Joe Biden's running mate is, right? We were supposed to really know last week, weren't we? After all, not that it makes any difference. Seriously, I saw a tweet from SE Cup the other day. This just goes to my immense disgust with Republicans who hate Donald Trump, so they think they can tell Democrats how we should run our party. And let me make this clear, if I haven't already done so. You guys screwed up your own party. Don't come to our house and tell us how to run things here. If you want to be a guest in our house, that's perfectly all right. If you want to party with us, that's fine. But don't tell us how to do things. You showed that you don't know how to do things because you let Donald Trump become your nominee and somehow con his way into the White House. So don't tell us what to do. So SE Cup writes this column. You know, I'm close to voting for Joe Biden, but it all depends on who he picks for a running mate. If it's Susan Rice, he can just forget about it. If he picks Kamala Harris, then he's got my vote. Well, you know what, SE Cup? Fuck you. Go home, go vote for Donald Trump, and stay in your little Republican world. I'm really so sick of it. That's why, again, I will sing the praises over, you know, people who have been. And look, that's not to say that I don't welcome those who have a legitimate change of mind, a change of view, a change of worldview. It happens to the best of us. Elizabeth Warren was a Republican when she was younger because she's from Oklahoma and she grew up in a Republican household. And once she got out on her own and went to college and started using her mind, well, guess what? Then she realized, oh shit, I'm not a Republican at all. I'm actually a Democrat. And as she worked her way through the world and the legal processes, after all, she worked her way up to become a law professor at Harvard, she realized she was a progressive Democrat, not just a D next to her name, but a progressive Democrat. And it happens. It's happened time and time again throughout the course of history. Cenk Uygur used to be a Republican. Lots of people did. So I don't have a problem with people growing up, expanding their worldview and understanding that, well, maybe, you know, the way I was taught by my parents isn't necessarily the right way forward. Happens to the best of us, right? What I do have a problem with is someone who is a Republican, who is still a Republican, lost control of their party, Steve Schmidt, and then thinks that he can all of a sudden just step into the Democratic Party and tell us how to do things. You know, I saw a piece, and Nicole Wallace is a prime example, and I actually like Nicole Wallace. I've never met her in person. I actually tweeted something nice to her once, and she responded to me, but she didn't bother following me back. Ooh. I've watched her show as it's evolved through the couple of years it's been on the air. And it's okay. You know, I give her a lot of credit for owning up to her mistakes. However, I don't know, and I don't watch enough to know how far into the world of penance she's gone. I do know that, you know, Steve Schmidt, saw someone posted a long Twitter thread of his the other day and said, oh, you got to read this. And so I read it. And he was bemoaning, you know, how we got to this point, and bemoaning not only Donald Trump's, but the Sarah Palin's of the world. And I got through the length of the thread, and I replied to somebody who commented on it, just because I have had enough Twitter fights in my life, really, to last a lifetime. But I said, and oh, let me think, because he commented directly on Sarah Palin, Steve Schmidt did. And I thought, oh, really, who was responsible for foisting Sarah Palin on the American public? Oh, right. Steve Schmidt. He was John McCain's campaign manager, and Nicole Wallace was his second in command. Steve Schmidt and Nicole Wallace were the two principals who ran John McCain's 2012 presidential campaign when they foisted Sarah Palin on the unsuspecting American public as his running mate. I still remember when they introduced her at that Republican convention, and I just thought, holy shit, this family is right out of Central Casting, and she can read a script with the best of them. And I was really scared that first night watching her perform, but that's exactly what it was a performance. Once she had to actually answer a question like, what newspapers do you read to inform your worldview? She couldn't answer that. But Steve Schmidt and Nicole Wallace evidently thought that, that Sarah Palin was qualified to be a heartbeat away from the presidency. And make no mistake, at that time, John McCain was no spring chicken either. You know, they're all talking about, well, you know, Biden's old. He may not make it through a first term. Well, there was a chance that had McCain won, that he wouldn't have either. So, you know, what's the answer? It's not coming into our house and telling us how to do things. I'll leave it there for now, because, you know, I'll come back to it. But this is an ongoing thing. So, again, keep your friends, well, keep your enemies close, but keep your friends closer. So there was a thing over the weekend about how MSNBC is shuffling their lineup, I think, effective a week from today, where Chuck Todd's Meet the Press Daily is being demoted. Gee, I wonder why that is. So Chuck Todd's not going to be on at 5 p.m. anymore, Eastern. Sorry, I'm on the East Coast, and we think the world revolves around us. So, you know, I'll do all times in Eastern Zone. And so the Chuck Todd's Meet the Press Daily moves now to 1 p.m. Eastern, and Nicole Wallace expands to 2 hours from 4 to 6 Eastern, and she'll be followed by Ari Melber, then Joy Reid. And then the primetime lineup of MSNBC. So, but then I saw a piece today that said there was actually a discussion among the honchos at NBC News to, you know, talk about moving Nicole Wallace into the slot, you know, hosting Meet the Press, because that's what we need. It's not enough that Chuck, you know, Todd, it does the journalist thing and pretends to be nonpartisan. You know, he won't go full out and say, yeah, I'm a disaffected Republican, but we know that's where he is. At least Nicole Wallace does that. I don't know if she's officially left the party. I think she has. I don't think she's officially a Democrat. But this is where they are. I happen to, for some reason, have Casey DC on yesterday afternoon. And I swear to you, every single one of her guests was a Republican or a never Trumper Republican. MSNBC, mark my words, is positioning itself to be the station in the middle. Forget progressives. Forget being an alternative to Fox. You know, they're owned by Comcast, and I guess that's what it's all about. You put your right foot in, you push your... Anyway. Anyway. I wasn't going to go off on that, but it's everywhere I look. Every time I turn on the TV, it's that. And, you know, I'm no great CNN fan either. Maybe they can hire someone who doesn't talk like they have marbles in their mouth all the time. There I am being cynical again. All right. Looks like there we go. All right. Looked like I froze for a second. Let's get something funny in here, because I'm showing that I'm kind of in a pissy mood, aren't I? Ugh, It's another week. All right. So I went in search of an unknown video artiste to share today. You know, usually on Mondays for the last few months anyway, we've been doing this Monday music thing. Today we're going to do Monday movie. I'll talk to you more about the music thing as we go on. Just I think I was enjoying it more than everybody else. The only way I know how you feel about these features that I work into the show is if you let me know. And you can email me anytime, Nicole@NicoleSandler.com. I read it all. I respond to most. Or you can, you know, you can tag me on Facebook or Twitter. I usually am pretty responsive to those as well. So anyway, the music thing, I love doing it. But as you know, from the last couple of weeks, I've tweaked the way we do them, because if the quality is not going to be good on the music, there's no sense in doing it. I was heartbroken a few times when an artist would be singing his heart out and the interweb connectivity is not conducive to that kind of artistry. So, you know, we did it with the Judith Owen and with Kevin Montgomery last week, where they recorded their end on their side, sent it to me, and I mixed them together. And we'll still do that. It's just a little more time consuming and takes more preparation. So instead of doing a Music Monday every Monday, they'll come sporadically and they'll be really special when we do them. All right. So they're not over yet, but we'll keep going when the situations present themselves. But today, it's a Monday movie, because we got a new movie to talk about with the producer-director Robert Greenwald of Brave New Films, and he's got a movie. It's short, it's sweet, it's so important, so he'll join us in a little while. We'll talk about it. It's called Suppressed. It's the fight to vote, the fight for the right to vote. Anyway, so I went searching for something, an unknown artiste, as it were, on the interwebs, who did something funny with their quarantine time. And I found a group that goes by the name of Unsubscribe Below. And I give them extra points for trying. The woman, Alanis Morissette, is not the easiest artist to cover. So I give the singer in this parody credit. To Universal Music Publishing Group, this is a song parody, so do not give me another copyright strike. It's fair use. It's a song parody. All right, here we go. It is, what do they call themselves? Unsubscribe Below, taking on Ironic. Here we go.
A rich white man who had a show on TV became the president in 2016. He peppers his speeches with outrageous lies. He says it's okay to grab women by surprise. And isn't he moronic? Don't you think? He's firing his expert advice, provoking wars without thinking twice. He says a pandemic will just go away, and who'd have thought he'd be here? He throws paper towels after hurricanes, serves fast food to athletes when they win the big games, builds border walls that can be climbed by preteens, abuses his office just to sell a can of beans. And isn't that moronic? Don't you think? He used a Sharpie to move the path of a storm, bought sex from Stormy, who's famous for porn. He told his fans to put bleach in their veins so he could sell them hydroxychloroquine. His friends have a funny way of not going to jail when they cover up for him, except when he throws them under the bus. His niece has some things to say about his narcissistic personality and says he is a sociopath. A test for dementia shouldn't be that hard. He should just join Mensa if he is really that smart. I mean, here is a guy who looks straight at the sun, and to bankrupt a casino must take a special kind of dumb. And isn't he moronic? Don't you think? A little too demonic. And yeah, I really do think. He's making blackmail calls to Ukraine. He's wishing well to his good friend Ghislaine. He's kidnapping protesters when they complain. And who would have thought it gets worse? And yeah, he has a funny way of driving us apart. But come election day, we'll be voting him out, voting him out.
It says Kofefi on the end screen. All right, the video produced by some people who go by the name of Unsubscribe Below, and their take on Alanis Morissette's ironic writing about Donald Trump. Moronic. Yeah, some things just write themselves, you know? All right, so one last thing on music, because we're going to move on from music today. We're going to get into a movie. But yesterday, I noticed, because of... a listener, an old radio listener of mine, who sent me a link to a YouTube video. Yesterday, August 9th, was the anniversary of Jerry Garcia's death. Jerry Garcia, for those who don't know, the unofficial leader of the Grateful Dead for most of its tenure. Jerry Garcia, again, died April 9th, 1995. And on that day, 25 years ago, I was hosting the morning show on KSCA, known as FM 101.9 in Los Angeles. And we wound up, we broke the news broke during the morning show, and I worked with my co-host, which was a man named Chuck Moshantz, who had done news for Mark and Brian when we worked together over there. He and I co-hosted the morning show for a little while together, as we did the day that Jerry Garcia died. And it's one of those things, you know, as we all get older, we're seeing the graying of our musical icons. And, you know, especially now with COVID, I do think about this onslaught of our idols' deaths that are coming up. You can't help but think morbidly a little bit when you're in the midst of a global pandemic, after all. And so that day, we wound up, because we were an adventurous music station in Los Angeles at a time when, you know, the industry was already going downhill and there weren't many adventurous music stations on the air in Los Angeles or elsewhere for that matter. So in LA, we were the only station that, you know, played Grateful Dead and Jerry Garcia music all day long once we got the news that Jerry had died. And it just developed organically. We wound up hosting a big vigil at Griffith Park in LA that night. Now, you got to remember, I wake up, or at the time, I woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning to be on the air at 6 a.m. Hosted a morning show that day. We got the news during the show that Jerry Garcia had died. We went into all of Grateful Dead mode. And then organically, this vigil started coming together that began that night at like 6 o'clock that I hosted. So, this one listener who reminded me yesterday what the day was shot a whole bunch of video that's up on YouTube. That's like an 8-part video epic of that day, of that event, the vigil at Griffith Park. And I have my air check from that day. And it's just, you know, it's again, it's the reason that I like to bring a musical element into the program, because it has such an important part in our lives. And if it doesn't, if music doesn't have that important part in your life, I don't know where you are in your life cycle, but I'm thinking you just haven't found the music that pushes your buttons for you. But it's out there, because music should be able to transport you to another place in time, into another mindset, improve your mood, or help you, you know, get those tears out. So anyway, if you are interested, I will post on the website today at NicoleSandler.com. I'll put up a special post with the air chuck from that day and some stuff from that vigil, if you're interested in seeing what went on 25 years ago. I know that I still, look, and I wasn't ever the biggest Grateful Dead fan, but I did appreciate a lot of the music, and I certainly appreciated the culture surrounding the Dead and went to enough shows and stuff. So anyway, 25 years, it goes like that. So there's that. All right. I'll tell you what. We got to get to some news before we get to Robert Greenwald. So let me, let's just do it, shall we? Let's get to some of the news right now.
I read the news today. Oh, boy.
All right. I don't even know where to begin, because I guess we begin with all the shit that happened over the weekend. So we'll start there. On Friday, another week wrapped up with another stalemate between congressional Democrats and White House negotiators. They were unable to agree on terms for another COVID relief package, meaning they remain gridlocked. So Democrats reportedly offered to slash $1 trillion off of their starting point, which is the $3.4 trillion HEROES package that they passed back in May. Again, the Democrats have had this legislation ready to go since May, and the Republicans would not even consider it. So the Democrats said, we'll come down a trillion, you come up a trillion. According to Pelosi, it was a flat no from White House officials. So Donald Trump decides on Saturday that he'll, after using his Bedminster, New Jersey private golf club to be a backdrop for his hour of commandeered television time on Friday afternoon, what a joke that was. I lasted all of 5 minutes before I said, get this shit off of my television, and we turned it off. He did it again on Saturday. And this time said he's going to use it for an executive order signing ceremony, using his private golf club, for which members pay hundreds of thousands of dollars for membership fees, to have access to the president in his, you know, exclusive club. Anyway, so his paying members were milling about with their wine glasses in hand, maskless for the most part, and as a cheering section. And they looked on and cheered and booed the media and did all the right things at the appropriate places as Donald Trump announced multiple alleged executive actions to extend economic aid. Now, the effectiveness and legality of the measures were unclear, however, with the order seemingly exceeding constitutional limits on executive power. But at this travesty of an event that we pay for, by the way, taxpayer dollars, because they called it an official White House event, Trump announced that he will unilaterally continue expanded unemployment benefits, but at $400 a week rather than the previous amount of $600 a week. He also said that he signed orders to pause student loan payments and extend the moratorium on evictions. And he said the action authorizes the Treasury Department to defer payroll taxes for Americans making less than $100,000 a year. But everything when it comes to Donald Trump is a lie. The Washington Post actually described these four so-called executive orders as, quote, just pretty books that Trump got to write on with a big marker. Yeah, that works. So, for instance, the $400 unemployment benefit, States would be on the hook for 25% of the extra payments if they decide to go along with it. And this weekend, Trump's chief economic advisor, Larry Kudlow, proved that he has no idea how any of this would work. Hold on, I think this is the one.
So when will people see their first checks?
This is the $400.
I don't want to be as specific because you might hold me to it, as you should, but I think it's going to be in a couple of weeks, and I think it's going to come to about $1,200 per person. That's a huge
wage increase. You keep saying $1,200 per person. Are you talking about in addition to the unemployment that they're already getting?
Oh, no.
Where does that number
that's
come
the
from?
Payroll.
Oh, my God.
I beg your pardon. The $1,200 will come from the payroll tax deferral.
Okay, we're going to get to that. Okay.
This, oh, my God.
There's a lot of numbers here, and it's a little confusing. I'm going to get to payroll tax in a minute.
It's a little confusing.
Go ahead.
It should be $800. I beg your pardon.
But it's $400. With the states
unemployed.
Paying one.
$800 or $400?
No, it should be $800.
Oh my
if the
God.
States step up, we're prepared to match. That should come out. $400 federal, $400 states.
Larry, what are you drinking?
Okay, we'll move on because I think this is that's not what the president said, and it's a bit confusing. And I think the fact that it's not entirely known is very telling.
Very telling. It's very telling. Larry Kudlow, the moron's chief. Chief economic advisor doesn't know how it works. And by the way, the payroll tax measure doesn't actually reduce the payroll taxes. It defers the due date for the portion of those taxes owed by employees, meaning that you, if you're the employee, are going to have to pay it back at some point. But in the meantime, this would put severe pressure on Social Security and Medicare because that's what's funded through those payroll taxes. And adding a payroll tax deduction does nothing for the millions of unemployed Americans who are not on any payroll to have deductions taken from. And there's this. There was actually no support for this payroll tax deduction on either side of the congressional divide. So everything about this is bullshit. In terms of reinstating the lapsed moratorium on evictions, no, it doesn't do that either. This thing that Trump signed yesterday with his big marker, it simply urges his cabinet to consider action on the issue. These were not bills. He kept calling them bills. Congress writes and votes on bills, not the White House. The documents Trump signed on Saturday were a combination of memorandums and one executive order. And the executive order is toothless. So, you know, there's all that. So Nancy Pelosi yesterday called Trump's executive orders absurdly unconstitutional. Right. And then today, Trump, I don't know if he said it or tweeted it. I guess it's the same thing. Oh, that Nancy and Chucky were like chomping at the bit to reopen negotiations. You know what that is? There's a technical term for that word, and it is
bullshit.
They did no such thing. They did no such thing. Okay. In other news. The number of confirmed coronavirus cases in the U.S. this weekend passed 5 million yesterday. 5 million. And there are about 163,000 deaths or more. The number of daily new infections is now averaging around 54,000, still way too high. And all those morons in South Dakota this weekend are all going to be getting COVID, I guess. It's all I can think of. Oh, and one more thing. There was another Friday night news dump that must not be ignored, and I will cover it at some point this week because we need to turn a lot of attention to this. The hashtag Friday Night Massacre trended on Twitter after the newly installed Postmaster General Louis DeJoy, who happens to be a major Trump donor and a big stockholder in companies that are competition to the U.S. Postal Service. Go figure that. What he did was, on Friday night, fired, reassigned, or displaced 23 top-level postal employees, executives. And now people are noticing that there is this slowdown that is affecting, and this could derail the I'm gonna rephrase that. It could make things even much more difficult to vote, because that's what Republicans want to do, is keep you from voting. So what you need to do is get that absentee ballot and hand deliver it to your supervisor of elections office. It's what we do. And it's what David, I guess, will do tomorrow, is hand deliver our ballots. You got to do it. I trust the Postal Service. I don't trust what Donald Trump is trying to do to the Postal Service. Okay? All right. So with that, let's do this. I told you Robert Greenwald was coming up. Robert Greenwald, of course, the founder and president of Brave New Films. He will be joining us in a moment to talk about this brand new movie that was just released that you must watch. And it's called Suppressed. The fight, I want to get it right, the fight to vote. And we're going to get Robert Greenwald on in just a moment. I'm going to play for you right now the trailer of the movie so you can see what it's all about. So from the latest from Brave New Films, Suppressed.
I think that mail-in voting is a terrible thing.
If you ever agreed to it, you'd never have a Republican elected in this country again.
We are witnessing a tidal wave of voter suppression around the country.
If you look at Alabama,
Arkansas, North Carolina,
and Georgia, which is becoming ground zero.
Georgia's tight race for governor is getting national attention.
Brian Kemp is not only the Republican gubernatorial nominee, he's Georgia's Secretary of State.
Stacey Abrams looking to make history by becoming the nation's first female African-American governor.
The Democrats are working hard, registering all these minority voters.
Civil rights leaders say Kemp is illegally removing people from Georgia's voters list.
The purges, they've been going on for over a century in this state.
My girl wanted to vote, and they were trying to keep her from voting.
The lies is crazy everywhere.
I tried contacting the Georgia Elections Board. My vote would not be counted.
I'm 65, and for the first time, I did not get a chance to vote.
We are not going to let them take from us what our grandparents and parents fought to give us in the first place.
The coronavirus pandemic is creating concerns ahead of the 2020 election.
We are here to resist an ID law that is undemocratic.
On my mother's dying bed at 92 years old, former sharecropper, her last words were, "Do not let them take our vote away from us."
Joining us now is the director, producer of the film, and the founder and president of Brave New Films, Robert Greenwald. Hey, Robert, thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure. Good to see you on Zoom.
It's good to see you, too. I love the new technology that allows us to do this stuff. It's amazing how far we've progressed in a relatively short period of time. So Brave New Films has been around a long time. We've been talking for, I can't even think about how many years. At Brave New Films, you have been producing and directing some of the most important documentaries, I think, in the past couple of decades. Before we talk about Suppress, the Right to Vote, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention some of the other amazing films that you've given us, like Outfoxed, which might be the first one I saw from Brave New Films, Rupert Murdoch's War on Journalism, Walmart, The High Cost of Low Prices, Iraq for Sale, Rethink Afghanistan, Koch Brothers Exposed, Warren Whistleblowers. It goes on and on. And the new one, out just last week, deals with this horrible thing we're living through, this voter suppression. It's a long fought battle that Republicans have waged to keep everyone from voting, isn't it? This is not something that they've just come up with in the last couple of presidential election cycles. This has been their strategy for a long time. Yes.
Yes, it's been a very long time. And one of the many things I actually learned, I mean, part of what I love about this work is how much you learn when you go into it. When I did the Koch brothers film, I actually learned from them about how they look at things long term. They're not just running and putting lots of money for some stupid 30-second TV spot at the last minute. They are working and they are funding educators, researchers, think tanks, local groups, the whole spectrum that creates social change. And with voter suppression, the Republicans, the conservatives, and the right, since the Supreme Court overturned the Voting Rights Act, they have been consistent in focusing on this. And as somebody says, I think it's Dr. Anderson, either in the film, she says, they are politicians looking to choose who the electorate is rather than the electorate choosing the politician.
Without a doubt. And that statement right there underscores exactly what gerrymandering is all about. It allows politicians to choose their electorate instead of, you know, you have geographically determined districts and who's ever running in there is voted on by the people there. But there's a clip that I've played on the show for as long as I've done it. And it's from 1980. And in fact, I played it just a couple of weeks ago when I spoke with Elise Hoag of NARAL North America, who also had a brand new book out. And she her book opens with the words of Paul Weyrich, who is one of the founders of ALEC. And from 1980, he was already vocalizing their strategy. And this is it.
Now, many of our Christians have what I call the goo-goo syndrome. Good government. They want everybody to vote. I don't want everybody to vote. Elections are not won by a majority of people. They never have been from the beginning of our country, and they are not now. As a matter of fact, our leverage in the elections, quite candidly, goes up as the voting populace goes down.
They play the long game. So that was from 1980. And here we are in 2020, and the fruits of their labor are finally paying off for them, where we are just, they are doing everything they can to keep us from voting. It's insane.
Yeah, we actually use that clip in the film. I mean, it's very important. And Trump is using almost those exact words where he's being transparent. And he said, if people voted by mail, then the Republican would never get elected again. He happens to be wrong about that, at least in the past. He may be screwing it up for them now by discouraging his folks to vote by mail. But curiously, with voting by mail, because it has skewed older, it has not been particularly one party or the other. We'll see if that changes in this election. And all of the work we're doing now with Suppress, which is available for free, and all of the short pieces we're doing are over and over again encouraging people who are not able to go to the polls or it's a safety issue to vote by mail.
Right. So again, Robert Greenwald is with us of bravenewfilms.org. The film Suppressed is available on YouTube. You had a big premiere about a week ago. It's hard to do premieres in the age of COVID when we're all quarantining. So you had kind of a Zoom premiere. Tell us who was there and what you did.
Well, we didn't have a red carpet, and mm-hmm. we didn't have a lot of celebrities walking down, but we never done that with our premiere, actually, even going back to Outfoxed and many of the others. What we did was we were able to work with, I think it was about 20 or 25 different groups, all of whom were partners in the premiere. Mm-hmm. Many of them carried the streaming of the film. We had Senator Booker, Senator Leahy. We had one of the people from the film. We had someone from Indivisible. We had a few other folks from groups speaking. And to my wonder and shock and amazement, we had 400,000 people view the premiere within, right? We got the numbers. Renato got the numbers in like a day or something. So it was quite extraordinary, which shows a few things. One is when you work together, we are so much more powerful. Mm-hmm. Secondly, as we do know, there's tremendous interest and concern about voting suppression. And third, because the film is free, anybody and everybody can become a distributor, can become an organizer. And with Zoom, it's even easier. You can have a house party, screen it, and invite people through Zoom to talk about it. Schools, churches, any place and every place. And then all over social media, from TikTok to YouTube to Facebook to Twitter. And there is interest, and our job is to give this tool to as many people as possible who don't want to just get up in the morning, read the paper or read their phones and get pissed off, mm-hmm, right?
Right.
Here is something you actually practically can do.
Right. And again, you've always done this with giving people the ability to host a screening. Again, now you sort of have to get creative because hopefully you're being responsible and staying home. But you do have screeners available for groups, although I'm guessing you'd prefer right now people do it virtually with the tools that are now available to us.
Yes, and we are. I mean, our goal is, in addition to the 400,000 who are at the premiere, is to have 2020 screenings before the 2020 election. And we're about 1,400, so I think we will make that. People are working very hard. We provide study guides. If it's school, we provide reflection guides. If it's a faith screening, we provide guides if you've never done a screening before, if you're organizing one with friends and colleagues. And then we provide short clips of it that are available, as I was saying, you know, from TikTok to YouTube and everything in between.
That's great. I love the idea of getting schools involved because this is a historical issue. We watched as, you know, it wasn't that long ago. It was when George Bush was still president. The Voting Rights Act was reaffirmed with something like a 99-1 vote in the Senate. And it's only since Barack Obama became president that all of a sudden Republicans have trouble with making sure everyone has access to the vote. We seem to be moving in the wrong direction there. So this is a perfect thing for schools to take up, especially while they're doing the remote learning. But so I got to ask you this, how much did you deal with the issue of vote by mail in the film? Obviously, Suppressed was in production before COVID hit us. Vote by mail was a thing. It's the primary mode of voting, I think, in 5 or 6 states. Here in Florida, where I live, I've been an absentee voter for years. Even though I'm still home, you're allowed to do that. You can vote by mail if you want to. It's only in the last couple of months, since Donald Trump realizes that he's vulnerable, that he's been trying to muddy the waters and say, ooh, voting by mail, that's not safe. That's going to mean fraud. Do you deal with that much in the film?
Well, as you said, the film was actually in production from right after the 2018 election in Georgia, which is when we started on it, right, and telling the stories of those incredible patriotic people. And as we were doing the interviews, I literally had this experience that, you know, and I've been to Afghanistan, I've been to Pakistan. I had the experience that I was in another country when I was hearing the stories about voter suppression. And they were deeply, deeply moving. So the vote by mail is a piece of this film. It's not the central piece. Mm-hmm. The central piece, and where I hope it will be helpful to people, is voting suppression, as Dr. Anderson says, is not somebody with a white robe hiding someplace. It's systemic. It's organized, and it's done in multiple ways, from long lines at the polls. Mm-hmm. How long would you wait to vote if you went and vote?
Me?
10 minutes?
Well,
20 minutes?
I'd wait for hours because I know what's at stake here, but the average person can't.
Right. We have people in the film who waited 2, 3, and 4 hours, lost a day's pay. Mm. This is voting suppression, as they talk about. It's resource allocation, making sure that there aren't enough machines in the African-American and the student areas, but that there are plenty of machines in the upper middle class white areas. There are purging. There is perfect match, all kinds of things. So the film's goal was to lay out and explain the complicated different issues, but do it in a way with emotion, with feeling, and with heart, and also now connect to vote by mail, the importance of voting by mail. We actually just finished a short piece with a group of wonderful seniors in Florida who talk about the importance of voting by mail that we'll be releasing in a couple of weeks, I think. And I want to stress to everybody that, again, a big part of this is so that everyone at home or wherever they are can do something, can get the film, forward it, get a little clip from the film, put it on your Facebook page. it's extraordinary the impact that real people have on other people. And we tend to minimize that. We tend to say, oh, well, we need some big company or we need ABC. It's not true. That's, you know, social media is obviously a mixed bag, but it allows every single one of you watching and listening to take some action to try to spread the word and be a part of the battle.
Absolutely. You know, I'm thinking back, looking at some of the other films that Brave New Films has produced and released. And I remember working very closely with you guys and Derek Crowe back then on Rethink Afghanistan. Yes. And back then we didn't have, I mean, there may have been Facebook, but it certainly you couldn't post videos. You couldn't do movie premieres. We couldn't Zoom an interview. We did radio interviews back then, and people had screenings. You would send out DVDs, and they'd have a screening of their Democratic Club or church group or whatever. So look how far we've... And that couldn't have been more than 10 years ago, right? It was about 10 years ago.
I mean, it's amazing. You know, I've been doing a whole series of speaking at screenings from this very chair.
Right.
Screenings all over the country at all times of night and day. We've been having, and it's available to people. We have people from the film zooming in to screenings.
Nice.
So we're trying to use the technology for the greater good and trying to make all these tools and help available so that everyone can be as effective as they want to be in making sure that they help spread the word. And again, it's all, every single bit of it is free. You can sign up at the website. You can follow me on Twitter and you'll get all of it so that it's going to be 84 days, whatever it is.
We're getting there. We're getting there. The website, by the way, you can get there at righttovote.org, which is specifically for this film, or go to bravenewfilms.org/screenings, and it'll tell you all about what to do, how to go about putting together a screening. And it's as simple or as complex as you want to make it, right? You'll give lots of resources, or you could just have a couple of people get together and say, let's watch this together on, you know, on the internet.
Or watch it separately and then have a Zoom discussion afterwards. I mean, it's the possibilities are fascinating right now.
So how do you decide what subjects you're going to tackle in one of these films, Robert? Because, again, looking at that screenings page at bravenewfilms.org, I rattled off a whole bunch of them at the beginning, but there's so many more. Do you just move from one project to another? Because it's you guys have just been putting out a trove of great documentaries here.
Oh, thank you. Well, we are a small nonprofit, and one of the wonderful things about being a nonprofit organization is there's some continuity. So there's quite an amazing group of women and men who work at Brave New Films, who are researchers, who are editors, who are associate producers, who work on distribution, who work on social media, who work on fundraising. We have 15 to 16,000 small donors, people who give us everything from $5 a month and up to foundations to bigger donors. But because we're a nonprofit, we have exactly that ability to keep working. So right now, there are probably 9 different projects in various stages. Many of them are the shorter pieces. There's the one about Florida senior citizens. We have this extraordinary woman whose coffee shop in Arizona did not get sufficient funds to keep going. And you see how much money the Trump folks got. You know, we've got, we're going to do a piece about the poll workers and how important it is to have younger people sign up to be poll watchers because otherwise the lines get worse. We've done a whole series about Trump and the money and the profiteering, and there's more coming. So we're constantly juggling them, and the editors and the producers and the researchers are all in a state of going from one to the other to the other.
And it's a constant stream of information. I mean, again, Brave New Films, you've been around now for about 20 years. And you've been doing this work consistently as the the capabilities of what we can do with the internet keep expanding. So now all these other little upstarts have come along. You know, you've been doing the long form films, but you've also been doing these short features throughout the years. And now you see groups like the Lincoln Project come along, or my new favorite, Midas Touch. What do you think of these new groups that are coming up and making these very creative, hard hitting short films, which is really what they are?
I think it's wonderful. I mean, it truly takes a village, and this is a battle and an audience. There are audiences who are all over the place, and different people are reaching different audiences, and some people are reinforcing. So I think it's very, very exciting. You know, when we started, it was lonely, lonely. There was nobody else out there, and it was a tough time. I still remember when one of my colleagues walked into the office the first day, and that was the time when we'd had to pay for storage on the internet.
Oh, right.
And he said, you know, there's this new thing and you could put your stuff up for free. And I said, what's it called? He says, well, it's called YouTube. And I said, well, why would anybody go watch it? And I went to YouTube, and there were, you know, women with shower curtains pulled across them, and there were cats playing the piano and other high-level things. But, you know, we put up a little bit of Rethink Afghanistan, and in 2 days, there were 7,820 people. And I said, wow.
Yeah. It's pretty remarkable. Now, interesting, because I'm actually suspended from YouTube at the moment for a bullshit copyright violation, which my listeners have heard enough about. I can post this on YouTube. I just can't stream live for the time being. So we're on Facebook Live and we're on Periscope. Somebody on Facebook, Tom, asked, does Link TV carry Brave New Films? So this is another interesting question, in that Brave New Films is not a channel, but you've got a library of films that you can get at bravenewfilms.org or on YouTube, or how do you tell people to access your films, Robert?
We tell them however they are comfortable. We are agnostic about how and where. And as you say, there's our, you know, our YouTube channel, our Facebook page. There are many groups that we work with and many colleagues who post them. And if you want to see all of the pieces, then sign up for our email list, sign up at Facebook, follow me on Twitter. Then you'll make sure to get them all and get them as quickly as they come out.
Absolutely. And as I have up on the screen for those watching on a video feed, Robert's Twitter account is Robert Greenwald. You can also follow at Brave New Films. Go to bravenewfilms.org. And I'm going to put all this on my blog at NicoleSandler.com, where I post the day's show. So today will be NicoleSandler.com/8-10-20, because it's August 8th. I try to make it easy for people, but they always still say, where can I find the podcast?
Yeah.
So it'll all be there. And it's so great to talk to you after all these years and watching how, you know, you've grown Brave New Films from this small little nonprofit documentary producer into this huge production house with all these great titles to your credit, and seeing how many others have grown up around you as the technology improves as well, and seeing people do stuff, you know, from their own homes. I've been marveling at people's creativity during the quarantine, during the time at home, and the creative funny videos they've come up with, because I've been trying to keep a sense of humor through all this, which is not always easy.
Yes, it's, I mean, definitely not easy, obviously important and inspiring. I mean, it's inspiring to see what people are doing and how they're doing it. You know, there's that other line I quote a lot, which is democracy is not a spectator sport, meaning don't sit on the sidelines. And so we see that. We see this outburst. It's one of the reasons we started getting involved with posting some things on TikTok. You know, I mean, the creativity there is off the charts.
Absolutely.
It's a little bit short in terms of attention span, but it is what, you know, that's what they're doing.
That's what it is.
Got quite a large audience.
Right. One last point that I wanted to make sure I touched on in the new film, Suppressed, is Stacey Abrams really is sort of like the spotlight is on her. This is a woman who not many Americans knew of before she ran for governor of Georgia in 2018 and had it stolen from her by the then Secretary of State, who coincidentally became governor because he got to oversee the elections as Secretary of State. Just one of the many problems in voting in Georgia, where they're still having problems as we go into the presidential race. Stacey Abrams is a very impressive, impressive woman.
Oh, she's amazing. She's truly inspirational. I've read both of her books, in addition, obviously, to interviewing and working with her on the film. And she really just gives personification to this combination of brains, dignity, and using her thoughtful ability to organize. I mean, think about it. She worked for 1 year, a year and a half, as she says in the film when I interviewed her. She went into people's homes. She talked to them. And when she saw the suppression taking the election away from her, it broke her heart. But rather than what the New Yorker would be, which I'd go out and probably try to strangle somebody,
you and me both.
She took the high road. She organized Fair Fight. They're a wonderful group. Mm-hmm. She organized Fair Count around the census. And she continues to walk the walk, not just talk the talk.
Are you optimistic? Do you think we're gonna make it through this 2020 election in one piece?
We are going to make it through. I'm convinced of it. And we're going to use the opportunities. You know, Naomi Klein talks about the opportunities that happen when there are catastrophes. And I think that we're going to be able to use the opportunity to try to move the country in more just and fair and equitable and safe ways. And it's going to take all of us.
I certainly hope so. And it will take all of us. And I hope everyone participates. Robert Greenwald, one last question for you. We didn't even get into, before you entered the nonprofit realm with Brave New Films, you had a long career producing and directing films and TV movies and miniseries. What's your favorite movie?
Well, that's like asking me what's my favorite child. Generally, my favorite movie is the one I'm working on right
course.
Now. I tend to be in the moment in that way. But I've been really fortunate when I did the commercial work where I was able to make some films that got attention and awards and also make some turkeys that I try never to talk about. And then in the work today, I feel every day that I'm able to get up. It's not easy, and we all have dark days, and we question ourselves and what we're doing. But to be able to work and create stories and narratives, tell them in a way that can reach an audience. And you talk about the true democracy and trickle-down theory. This is it. You put a video up.
Mm-hmm.
If you put a gun to people's heads, they're not going to pass it along to their friends and relatives unless they believe in it. So we see that every day. And I appreciate so much, Nicole, the work you're doing and that the members of your audience do. And thank all of you for everything.
Well, it's gonna take all of us. And the reason I asked about, you know, what you do, you know, music or movies in this case that you love, is because you're so entrenched in really difficult situations. If you go through their filmography, you see you hit up such intense subjects. And we need a break from time to time. We need a diversion. It's why I try to focus on music or movies or other things. So I'm looking for something when you've had enough of Trump and you can't stand the stupidity and you can't believe the world has descended to this and people won't wear masks. What is a great escape for you?
Right now, Seinfeld.
Ah. Okay.
I discovered that the full 7 years, or I think it's on Hulu, and I just finished watching this amazing documentary on Netflix, Migration Nation, which is brilliant and devastating. But I could only watch an hour, and then we'd watch a half hour of Seinfeld.
Good, because you need the laughter. I gotcha. I hear you. Yeah, I may have to revisit that. You know, again, like music, things like that take you back to a certain period of time. And boy, I remember that because when Seinfeld hit the air, I was living in LA at the time, and I worked with Mark and Brian at KLOS, and they had a TV show premiere on NBC the same time Seinfeld premiered. They had The Adventures of Mark and Brian, and we were at the big thing that NBC threw for the advertisers, and I remember thinking, oh yeah, Jerry Seinfeld, I know him. He's a comedian. He's kind of funny, and look where we are, you know, all these years later. slice of life of time. Yes. Anyway, now here where we are, and maybe in 25 years, people will look back and say, that movie, Suppress, The Fight to Vote, got people off their asses. So watch it. It's on YouTube. I will put links on my blog. I will have it all out there. But go to rightfighttovote.org, and you'll see it there too. Robert Greenwald, thank you so much. It was great to talk with you again.
And I hope you can do it again. Thank you, Nicole.
You take care. Bye-bye. And with that, we're done. Have a great day, everyone. Tomorrow's Tuesday. Got a Laugh will be here. And yeah, we'll take it from there. And go watch the movie. Go to YouTube. Look for Brave New Films. All right. Bye, everyone. Have a great day.